Wi-Fi 6 has been around for a while now. I did my first video on a Wi-Fi 6 access point back in March 2020. But even to this day, I still get a ton of questions and comments asking about Wi-Fi 6. What is it? Should I upgrade to Wi-Fi 6? Is it faster, better, stronger? So let's take a look at all of the features of the Wi-Fi 6 wireless standard and figure out once and for all if you need to upgrade your home or business network to this latest technology. Did you know that only 25% of the people who watch my videos are actually channel subscribers? Subscribing is hands down one of the best ways to support Crosstalk Solutions so that you don't miss out on any of the quality content that we're serving up here on YouTube. And best of all, it's absolutely free. Wi-Fi 6 is the sixth generation of the Wi-Fi standard, also technically known as IEEE 802.11ax. It was developed to address the increasing demand for higher speeds and better performance in wireless networking. But one of the big misconceptions about Wi-Fi 6 is that it's going to increase speeds to your individual devices, which it might, a bit, if those devices are fully Wi-Fi 6 capable and if they have a decent sized antenna. But by and large, the features of Wi-Fi 6 are designed to improve the efficiency in dense client environments rather than the range or speed for individual devices. They're designed to make the airwaves that data travels through more efficient in order to squeeze more bandwidth for more devices out of the available wireless bands. Or in other words, as your device count increases, Wi-Fi 6 is going to provide better throughput and speeds than having the same number of devices on a Wi-Fi 5 wireless network. One of the ways that Wi-Fi 6 accomplishes more density is by utilizing both the 2.4 GHz and the 5 GHz frequency bands. Older generations of Wi-Fi, Wi-Fi 4 or 802.11n, use the 2.4 GHz band only. Wi-Fi 5, on the other hand, use the generally better performing and less crowded 5 GHz band. Wi-Fi 6 is able to take advantage of both of these bands combined and more. There's also the 6 GHz frequency band, which was recently made available for use in the United States and other countries. Devices that can take advantage of the 2.4 GHz, 5 GHz, and 6 GHz bands use an extension of Wi-Fi 6 called Wi-Fi 6E. The key difference between Wi-Fi 6 and Wi-Fi 6E is that Wi-Fi 6E devices are specifically designed to operate in the 6 GHz frequency band, whereas Wi-Fi 6 only devices may not support operation in the 6 GHz band. Wi-Fi 6 also opens up a new channel width option of 160 MHz. Channel width refers to the amount of spectrum that's used to transmit data over a wireless connection. In general, a wider channel width allows for higher data rates and better performance, but it can also be more susceptible to interference. So the size of the channel width used in any particular environment should be determined after taking some measurements of the wireless spectrum in the area. All right, now here is where we're gonna get a bit more technical, but I am going to try to simplify these features of Wi-Fi 6 as much as possible. Past generations of the wireless standard introduce us to MIMO, or MIMO, however you want to pronounce it is totally fine. It stands for multiple input, multiple output, and basically it means that a single device has the ability to communicate over multiple channels at once. Wi-Fi 5 brought us MU-MIMO, or multi-user MIMO, which allowed up to four paths to be utilized in a downstream and upstream simultaneously. I like to think of MIMO as lanes on a highway, and the cars driving down that highway are data packets from your client devices. If you purchased a Wi-Fi 5 access point that featured 4x4 multi-user MIMO capability, this means that it had the ability to service four lanes of quote-unquote traffic in each direction, upload and download. Some of your client devices may have 2x2 antennas that take up two of those lanes, some might have 3x3 antennas, and so on. If you have a 4x4 multi-user MIMO access point, it can handle two 2x2 devices simultaneously or four 1x1 devices. Wi-Fi 6 has expanded multi-user MIMO capability to 8x8, so our theoretical highway just doubled in size with Wi-Fi 6, which means that more devices can be communicating back and forth simultaneously. Again though, this speaks to device density in the airwaves, not necessarily the specific speeds of any single device. Another huge improvement to Wi-Fi 6 is orthogonal frequency division multiple access. That is a mouthful. So we're going to call it OFDMA for short. All right, this is basically a fancy way of saying that Wi-Fi 6 has the ability to chop up available bandwidth into smaller slices, also known as subcarriers, that allow multiple devices to send and receive data simultaneously on the same frequency band, rather than having to take turns accessing the channel as they would have had to do in previous wireless standards. OFDMA is especially beneficial in dense environments where there are many devices competing for access to the wireless network. So imagine trucks driving down our imaginary Wi-Fi highway. With previous generations of Wi-Fi, all of the trucks were the exact same size, regardless of how much cargo, right, data, they were actually transporting. Now, these trucks or packets can be varying sizes, which again increases efficiency and conserves overall bandwidth. Now let's talk about QAM, which is to me one of the more challenging aspects of Wi-Fi to understand. QAM stands for Quadrature Amplitude Modulation, and it's a method of encoding digital information, such as bits, into an analog signal, such as a radio wave. With QAM, the analog signal is divided into a grid of symbols, each of which represents a unique combination of amplitude, or how high or low the signal is, and phase, which is the timing of the signal, or how far the signal has shifted from a specific reference point. By using these various symbols, QAM can transmit a large amount of digital information using a relatively small amount of bandwidth. Wi-Fi 5 is 256 QAM, or a grid of 16 by 16 symbols. Wi-Fi 6 increases QAM to 1024, or a grid of 32 by 32 symbols, which essentially means that Wi-Fi 6 is able to cram more data into the same radio waves. Another improvement is spatial frequency reuse, also known as OBSS or BSS coloring. With previous generations of Wi-Fi, access points that were close together but on the same channel would interfere with each other. Now, access points that are in range of other access points running on the same channel can use a unique color identifier that allows them to communicate over the same channel at the same time without interfering with other devices that are also on that same channel but are a different color. So interference only happens when you've got multiple access points with the same BSS color that are within range of each other. Next, we have beamforming. Now, beamforming has been around since Wi-Fi 5. The concept of beamforming is that an access point, rather than just beaming its data in every direction like a light bulb, has the ability to focus its wireless signal into a specific direction, which helps to improve both range and speed of the wireless connection, especially in environments with obstacles or interference. So imagine that this access point is doing beamforming and it's up on a ceiling or wall somewhere and it's communicating with this computer right here. Essentially, with beamforming, the signal and the communication from the access point to this computer can be sent down one specific lobe of the wireless signal pattern that is emanating out of this access point. So it's not just bursting the data omnidirectionally anywhere that this access point can see, it's sending it specifically down one of the lobes because it knows that this device lives down that direction. Wi-Fi 6 introduced enhanced beamforming, which allows the access point to more accurately target its signal to individual devices. It increases the number of beams that a device can transmit from 4 to 8. All right, so is your brain hurting yet? I promise you that we are almost done, but there are a couple more important features to talk about. Target wait time and uplink resource scheduler. All right, so these two features are fairly similar in that they tell client devices when to sleep and when to wake up so that they don't have to be transmitting all the time. Imagine going to Disneyland and using a fast pass or like a VIP pass, right? Your access to a ride is scheduled so that you just show up when it's time to get on the ride rather than having to wait in a big long line for an hour, right? Target wait time and uplink resource scheduler kind of work like that FastPass. They tell your devices specifically when they can transmit data, which decreases wireless interference, but more importantly, it allows your devices to essentially turn their antennas off when they're not in use, which saves that device's battery power. Now, this is especially important for anything battery powered, such as like smartphones and IoT devices. Okay, so even if you don't fully understand the complexities of all of these Wi-Fi 6 features, it should be pretty clear that most of these features are focused on increasing efficiency and reducing interference. They are not necessarily designed to increase the speed or range of any single device. That being the case, should you upgrade to Wi-Fi 6? Well, let's break that into home users versus business users. For home users, you likely don't have enough devices for Wi-Fi 6 to have a significant impact on your wireless network if you're already running Wi-Fi 5 access points. And of course, I know there are always exceptions to the rule. I can already hear the comments of people telling me how many smart lights and IoT devices they have in their home, but seriously, let's be real. Most folks do not have the density of devices that would benefit from Wi-Fi 6 at home. I mean, I personally have a ton of wireless devices in my home, and I doubt if I would be able to distinguish any difference between Wi-Fi 5 and Wi-Fi 6 personally. In my own network, I actually have a mixture of Wi-Fi 5 and Wi-Fi 6 access points, and everything's working perfectly fine. So is it worth upgrading if you're a home user? Probably not. And as the saying goes, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. But if you're buying new, you might as well go ahead and get the latest and greatest. I mean, it's actually gonna be more difficult to find Wi-Fi 5 access points these days anyways. Now for businesses, basically the same deal, right? If you're a small to medium business with 100 or so wireless devices spread out through your building and you've already got an investment in Wi-Fi 5 access points, you probably won't see much benefit upgrading to Wi-Fi 6. However, if you are the administrator of a location where hundreds of people congregate, such as an event center, movie theater, a church, sports stadium, right? These places can definitely benefit from an upgrade to Wi-Fi 6 and should remain relatively future-proof for a number of years. So what's next, right? What is the future of wireless? Now, I've already seen vendors touting Wi-Fi 7. I'm looking at you, TP-Link. But Wi-Fi 7 is not a formally recognized version of the Wi-Fi standard. The next version of Wi-Fi is actually expected to be Wi-Fi 8, also known as 802.11be. But since that standard is still in development, it's not yet clear when devices with Wi-Fi 8 capability will be available on the market. And the Wi-Fi Alliance hasn't even announced a timeline for the release of the Wi-Fi 8 standard. And when they do release that timeline, it's still probably gonna be years before devices are actually using it. I mean, you look at Wi-Fi 6, it was first released in 2019, but we really didn't start to see mass availability of Wi-Fi 6 access points until like a year or two later. So I hope this helps to clear up where we stand with Wi-Fi 6 here at the end of 2022. The most basic takeaway from this video should be, if you already have a working, stable Wi-Fi 5 network, upgrading probably won't give you much benefit in most cases, but if you're buying new, you might as well buy into Wi-Fi 6 because it's a standard that's gonna be here for at least a few years, if not longer. All right, special thanks to OpenAI's ChatGPT for helping me do research on this video, and I'd love to see you stick around to check out one of these videos on the right that I have handpicked for you to watch next. The top video is a tour of the network setup used at PDX LAN, a massive 600 user gaming event, and the bottom video is a tutorial on how to best optimize your own wireless access points.